MedCram.com.
Well, welcome to another MedCram lecture. We're going to go over this EKG just like we do in our EKG course at MedCram.com. So the first thing that we want to do is get the history, and this happens to be a 78-year-old Caucasian male found down in a nursing home with a temperature of 85 degrees Fahrenheit. So the first thing that we want to do, like we learn in the course, is go over rate, rhythm, and axis. Okay, rate, rhythm, and axis. So the first thing on rate is you can notice here that there are QRS complexes, and what you really want to do is look at the rhythm strip, which is down here, and you'll notice here and here and at various places along this rhythm strip are QRS complexes, which are pretty irregular, which means it's going to be difficult for you to use the box method of calculating the distance in time between each QRS complex. So, you know, when we're talking about these big boxes here, how many boxes are there between these QRS complexes? And you know that the first box is going to be 300, the second box is going to be 150, and the next one is going to be 100. But the problem here is that these QRS complexes are irregularly spaced. So whenever I have something like this where we may be dealing with atrial fibrillation, the way I like to do it is look at a whole rhythm strip and make sure that we're going at 25 millimeters per second, which is the standard paper. And all you do is you just take the number of QRS complexes in one standard size EKG strip and you multiply it by 6. And the reason why is it takes 10 seconds to do the entire strip. So you're seeing how many complexes are there in 10 seconds. And of course, there's 60 seconds in a minute. So let's go through it. We've got 1, 2, 3, 10, 11. So 11 times 6. So our rate is 66. Okay, well, what about the rhythm? So look at the rhythm strip again, and you'll notice in this situation that there are really no P waves before these QRS complexes. So I do believe because of the irregularity and because of the lack of recognizable standard P waves that we're dealing with atrial fibrillation. Okay, finally, axis. Now, this is sometimes where people get confused. Let's go ahead and review axis like we do in the course. So the best way that I can remember how to do axis is just draw a circle, draw a center hole. And the way I remember this is to remember whenever you've got, for instance, an inferior myocardial infarction, you're always going to look at the bottom of the heart with leads 2, 3, and AVF. So 2 is going to be generally pointing down, 3 symmetrically on the other side, and then AVF. Okay? Now, of course, you can extend those back because it's exactly the same axis. It's just the negative aspect of it. Now, we know that lead 1 goes off in this direction. So that's Roman numeral 1. And so really all you have to do is fill in the other ones. And so that's going to be AVR, because that's the right side of the body. And here, that's going to be AVL. So we should have 6 leads. Okay? We've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. And each of these is spaced out by 30 degrees. Okay? So we're going to go through this looking at the EKG strip. So the first thing that I like to do in terms of trying to figure out what the axis is I always do the 90 degree coordinates, 1 and AVF. Now they're both positive here and here. And as you recall, the axis is always measured from this, and it's always measured positive this way, and it's always measured negative this way. So if we're positive and positive, we've got to be in this quadrant. So let's take a look at our EKG. Okay, so here we're going to look at lead 1, which is right here, and we're going to look at AVF, which is down here. Notice that in AVF and in 1, we both have a positive QRS complex. So what does that mean? That means that our axis is going to be somewhere in this quadrant. which is normal. That's where it should be. But let's refine it even more. Is it closer to lead 2? Is it closer to the negative of AVR? Exactly where is it that we're talking about? Well, there is another way of doing that, and that is looking at to see whether or not the amplitude of the QRS is higher in AVF or 2, or if it is most negative in AVR. That'll tell us where along here it is, or even in Roman numeral lead 1. So let's take a look. So if we look at this, we can see that AVF seems to be the highest at around 10 millimeters here, whereas Roman lead 2 is only about 8 millimeters. And if we look at AVR, here it's negative by about, I would say about 9 millimeters. So the one that it's highest to is AVF. But remember, Roman numeral lead 1 shows that it actually is positive, so it's not right on AVF. It's got to be just off of it. So we would look at this and say that it's probably running right along here, somewhere in this range. Now, if that's the case, then that would mean that it's perpendicular closest lead, which in this case would be AVL, should be isoelectric. Why? Because it's perpendicular to the maximum amplitude. So when we go back and look at the EKG, let's look at AVL and see if that one has the lowest amplitude. And of course, when we look at it, we can see very clearly out of all of these limb leads, AVL has the lowest amplitude, and that confirms that our axis is around 60 to 67 degrees, which would be right around where we predicted it would be. Okay, so that's how you can do axis. There's actually several ways of doing that. So we'll just round it off and say 60 degrees. Okay, so we've got rate, rhythm, axis. Now, are there any kind of funny ST segment changes? And the answer is yes. You can see here a kind of notching. Now, there's several names for this notching. It's known as the J wave, or even called an Osborn wave. The reason why it's called an Osborn wave is because it was discovered in 1953 by a guy named Osborn, who was doing research in something very interesting. It was research in hypothermia. And that kind of gives away why you might see a J wave or Osborn wave. Now, first of all, it's known as many other things. It's known as a camel hump sign, a late delta wave, a hat hook junction, a hypothermic wave, a K wave, an H wave. So there's a lot of different names for it, but you'll see J wave and Osborn waves the most. And it can be related to a decrease in temperature of the patient. So this is pretty classic for this. You might see this on boards. And typically when the patient has a temperature of less than 90 degrees Fahrenheit. As we said, this patient actually was 85 degrees Fahrenheit, so it certainly would make sense. But you can also see it in hypercalcemia. You can see it in brain injury. And you could also see it in vasospastic angina. And you could also see it in VFib. But the one that you ought to know about and remember is decreased temperature, Osborn wave, J wave, and that's what it looks like. Let's take another good look at some of these examples. But first, let's look at a close-up. Basically, it is a rebounding after the J point of this hump that comes after the R wave. And again, here's another example. Typically, you'll see it in the precordial leads. So there is a J wave. And again, remember this in patients who are hypothermic. Okay, well, we've gone through another EKG. Join us over at medcram.com for our EKG course, because the more EKGs you do, the better you get. Thanks for joining us.